يا ربي لك الحمد كما ينبغي لجلال وجهك ولعظيم سلطانك. الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله الواحد الأحد الفرد الصمد الذي لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. قل اللهم مالك الملك تؤتي الملك من تشاء وتنزع الملك ممن تشاء وتعز من تشاء وتذل من تشاء، بيدك الخير إنك على كل شيء قدير. وأشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدا صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم عبده ورسوله، وما أرسلناك إلا رحمة للعالمين. لقد جاءكم رسول من أنفسكم عزيز عليه ما عنتم حريص عليكم بالمؤمنين رؤوف رحيم، فإن تولوا فقل حسبي الله لا إله إلا هو عليه توكلت وهو رب العرش العظيم. من يطع الله ورسوله وأولي الأمر من المؤمنين فلا مضل له، ومن يعص الله ورسوله وأولي الأمر من المؤمنين فلا هادي له، ومن يتوكل على الله فإن الله على كل شيء قدير. أما بعد، brothers and sisters, committed Muslims, Allah our maker, our creator, he who's most knowledgeable of human nature and is watchful of our tendencies and our actions, he says to us, as an expression of mercy, lest we go astray and suffer thereof. He says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ حَقَّ تُقَاتِهِ وَلَا تَمُوتُنَّ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ. يا أيها الذين آمنوا، avoid Allah's corrective power as is due to him. اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. and do not die except in a state of acquiescence to Allah. In another ayah, Allah Jalla wa Ala says, Ya ayyuha an-nas, ittaqu rabbakum alladhi khalaqakum min nafsin wahidah. O people, avoid the corrective power of Allah, who has created you from one nafs. In another ayah, Allah says, وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا وَيَرْزُقُهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ. And he who avoids Allah's corrective power, Allah will present him with a way out of his predicament and provide him from sources that go beyond the calculations of that particular person. وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا وَيَرْزُقُهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ. There are many ayat in Allah's accurate words to us that are showing us how to behave, how to settle our thoughts, how to formulate our direction and move forward. Mind you, these numerous ayat in which at-taqwa is featured predominantly are meant to infuse our minds and our hearts with calculating Allah's power in a world that is systematically, psychologically, and militarily set up to deny him his power. And what if there are physical nation states with militaries with the think tanks they have, with so-called scholars, with all of the rest of what seems to be substantial power? What if they are saying the opposite of what Allah is saying? And they are not saying it in a way to appear to be opposed to Allah. They can easily dismiss Allah from our serious thoughts and then diminish him to become a matter of a few minutes during the day when the faithful go to their salah or go to the masjid, to be placed in a trance relationship with Allah. Not a vital relationship, not a conscious relationship, but a trance relationship with Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is feeding us with what will nurture our determination and our thinking ability. If we choose to listen to him, it's our choice. Some of us may choose to listen, and some of us will choose not to listen. And some of us will pretend to be listening, and then they will seize every opportunity to violate the meanings that are communicated to them. When Allah is speaking to us about his overwhelming power, he is making it clear that his power is not going to take effect in human life if we just choose to limit his words to our ears. There is more to a relationship with Allah than what the ear is listening to. There are vital meanings that Allah is communicating to us. And we have to be true and objective of the world around us. Who can deny that those who are opposed to Allah have the physical power? Who denies that? Allah doesn't expect us to be as idealistic as to become unable to look at reality as it is. We confess that those who are against Allah have the physical force. But the issue doesn't begin with this confession, and it doesn't end with this confession. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ حَقَّ تُقَاتِهِ وَلَا تَمُوتُنَّ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, guard yourselves against Allah's corrective power as is due to him. These people don't give Allah his corrective power, even though they pray to him, even though they are privately and individually professing to be his servant. But Allah is not going to measure a human being by surface appearance. Allah is going to penetrate the way you look, the way you speak, the decorative words you use from the Quran and the Sunnah to hide your reality. These people who come to these masajids, can anyone deny that when they begin their prayers, they say, Allahu Akbar? The first thing that is said in preparation for being in the presence of Allah during the solemn moments of Salah is Allahu Akbar. Do they mean that? To the contrary, they don't mean Allahu Akbar. They say it. Saying it is one thing, and meaning it is something else. We don't deny, no Muslim in the world, no human being with his right mind is going to deny, people don't say, Muslims don't say, Allahu Akbar. But beyond just the verbiage of language, there is a human intent. There is a human conscience. There is a human determination. There is a human will. Do the words Allahu Akbar, are they planted in the conscience of the person who is saying it? And anyone and everyone in their right mind will tell you no. These words are tongue deep only. They don't penetrate deep down into the psyche of the individual who is saying it, nor into the individuality of the Islamic society to which these words belong. You need proof? You look. Allah brings lessons, information, instruction our way. You saw in the past couple of months a military that belongs to those who are against Allah. Kafirs, mushriks, zalims, the whole bunch. They use this military on individuals, on traditional societies, on cultural pockets, on historical human residuals who say, who pronounce, who enunciate, who verbalize Allahu Akbar, which is a demonstration. The word Allahu Akbar is a demonstration that a person wants to factor in the power of Allah into the life and existence around. What happens? There are other Muslims. There's 1.5 billion other Muslims around in the world. What were they doing when all of this was going on? What were they doing? Once again, they were only surface deep. They were participating in this whole affair with their senses, watching, listening, reacting, sensually, physically, and in sometimes a form of entertainment. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ حَقَّ تُقَاتِهِ ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. And don't die except that you are yielding to Allah's power. They don't factor in Allah's power to yield to it. So when they die, do they die in a state of Islam to Allah? And the obvious answer to that is no. We do not die in a state of Islam to Allah. And these events that have come our way only help us to understand what we are and who we are. And why does Allah say, وَلَا تَمُوتُنَّ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ? Could have easily said, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ حَقَّ تُقَاتِهِ وَلَا تُقَاتِلُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ وَلَا تَقُومُوا إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses his words carefully because he sees through tradition, his observations penetrate the shells of culture around, and he knows how we are apt to become. And he realizes that we only pay close attention to the power of Allah when we have given up on worldly powers and we are about to return to Him. That's the moment when we expire from this life and existence. So Allah went fast forward with us. He brought us before we reach that inevitable minute when we part with this world. And He reminded us of the true power, not these false powers around that come and go, rise and fall, increase and decrease. No. Allah brought us to the moment in which we will, if we have been trying to fool ourselves about this fact, the moment and minute will arrive when it will present itself to us fairly and squarely. And in another ayah, Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ اتَّقُوا رَبَّكُمُ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُمْ. O people, and this goes beyond Muslims, this is a general address to any human being. Take notice of Allah's corrective power who has created you. But that moment in which we were created is behind us. The moment in which we are asked to identify Allah's power and side with Allah seems to be elusive when we are created and when we are going to die. And in between, we have this expanse in which we want to avoid reckoning with Allah's power. If our mind can absorb and assimilate these words of Allah that are meant to be planted in the core of our heart and at the center of our thoughts, if we can come to understand the relevance and the germane meaning of these communicative words, then we can take a healthy look at the world around and be comfortable with saying, describing, and trying to define the events around us. Brothers and sisters, we are not responsible for things that happen from history. We can learn from them, but we're not responsible for them. We're not responsible for things that are going to happen in the future. We can speculate, but we are not responsible for them. We are responsible for the events and the issues and the developments of our time and our day, and our here and our now. Allah's Prophet, we all Muslims, some of us genuinely, and those are not many, and many of us just as a matter of custom and culture, have a vague affinity with Him. What did He do? The same mind that is required to absorb and assimilate the ayat of the Qur'an, that same mind is also required and responsible for assimilating and absorbing the behavior of Allah's Prophet. Nowadays, just like the word taqwa has become meaningless, yes, it's not off course to say that the word taqwa in the mainstream cultural and traditional Muslim mind has lost its significant meaning. Who wants to say that taqwa is an accelerated consciousness of Allah's power presence in human life? That means a lot. If Allah has a power presence in the affairs of this world, then why are the Saudis and the Saudi government and the Egyptian government and the Iraqi government and the Syrian government and the other governments, why are they not factoring in the power of Allah when they make decisions that impact your life and my life? You count the number of times as taqwa and its derivative meaning are mentioned in the Quran, and you will see that only a person who has shut off his mind is willing to forego Allah's book, Allah's communication, Allah himself and his prophet for the sake of maintaining Islamic rituals and Islamic traditions in a calcified shell. If Allah is a power to be reckoned with in this life, why are those people who are in charge of Mecca and in Medina, why do they behave as if Allah can be satisfied with words? They want to satisfy Allah with a few words during Salah time and a few words during Hajj time, and they want to get Allah off their back. This is more difficult for us to say than it is for them to do. If they wanted to take a closer look at Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what did he do? He invites whatever is left of their thinking capability to come into contact with this last and universal messenger of Allah. He used to go to the Hajj. When the Hajj was corrupt, he used to go to the yearly meeting of the opinion makers in Arabia. He used to go to where the aristocrats and the elite of Mecca met in Dar and Nadwa. He didn't say, look, the way I am going to pursue this da'wah, this is the Saudi style, and this is what they have imposed on him and by extension imposed on us. They say, yes, you're free. Look at the freedom that the United States government offers to the Muslims. And now it's trying to make a sample out of that in Iraq. Look, if you want to preach Islam, if you want to explain the Quran, go. Look at the people around. Look how many people there are in this world to go to speak to. But is that what Allah's Prophet did? In addition to his one-on-one contact with the individual nomad in Mecca and Arabia, he did not limit himself to that. He went to where there were mass meetings of multitudes of people. And he didn't say, I'm not going to go there because the Hajj is corrupt. The Hajj, the way it was administered by the aristocrats of Mecca, was corrupted. It wasn't just
The Hajj, the way it was administered by the aristocrats of Mecca, was corrupted. It wasn't al-Hajj al-Ibrahimi. It was a mushrik Hajj administered by mushrik with idols all around. He said, no, I'm not going to go into the Kaaba because these idols are around. If the Saudi mentality was superimposed as it is today on us, if it was superimposed on him, he would not want to go to Mecca. Meaning, to al-Masjid al-Haram, to al-Haram al-Ibrahimi, to the Kaaba, he would not want to go in there. But he did. And look at the difference between those who ruled Mecca at that time and those who rule Mecca today. Let's say a certain person who is not brainwashed by the Saudi CIA Islam wants to go to Mecca to speak to the people there, to the Kaaba, to speak to the faithful there about Allah and His Prophet. These occupiers of Mecca and Al-Medina will not let that happen. Abu Jahl and Abu Lahab and Abu Sufyan and the rest of the Abus of that time were better than Fahd and Sultan and Nayyid and the corrupt kings and princes that rule with the support of the mushrik over these Islamic sanctuaries. Taqwa? Speak to anyone about taqwa and it's a turn off. And it's meant to be a turn-off. No, we can't afford to say that Allah's ayat have no meaning, especially at a time when our blood is flowing. What do we do, brothers and sisters? What do? When we find ourselves on the path of Allah's Prophet? They came to human beings. They interacted with human nature. And many times these humans just turned the other way. This is a long historical course that we find ourselves on. And our solace comes from being in the grain of us with Allah, growing and maturing from one experience and challenge to the next. The Hollywood war is over now. Now it's the real thing. You push a few hundred thousand forces, military forces, in these Muslim territories, thinking that you have enough ignorance to substantiate your presence that is predicated on giving freedom to people who are enslaved by your own extension. This is the roundabout, complex predicament that they think that they are placing us in. No, we want the day to come when the Muslim understanding of Allah and His Prophet will give us enough confidence to say that we are willing to go to the Dar al-Arqam of today, to the Souq al-Kaab of today, to the Mecca and Medina of today, and let the positive effects of understanding Allah and His Prophet rub off on those who are willing. But what do? When those who are against Allah and prove it by their military and their killing. Notice, they said they don't want to count how many people were killed in Iraq. To them, it's dismissed as collateral damage. This is how they try, just like they hide behind diffusing Islamic words. You can diffuse a taqwa, say it is piety. There goes the whole concept. There goes the whole relationship to Allah in scores of ayat in the Quran, just by changing one word. They couldn't take the word taqwa itself out of the Quran. They know that. إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرِ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ. Indeed, we have integrated this dhikr down inside the human condition. As it is, this Quran, from surah to surah, from the first page to the last page, لَا يَأْتِيهِ الْبَاطِلُ مِنْ بَيْنِ يَدَيْهِ وَلَا مِنْ خَلْفِهِ. They know they can't falsify it in its integral, preserved form. So the second best thing to do is to alterate its meaning, transform its the meanings of key words in the Quran. So what do you do when they have, at that level, gone in that deep inside the Muslim mind, and then on the other level, they try now to fool the Muslims by saying that they have gotten rid of a tyranny which they supported, they supplied, they administered, they financed, they coached. And now they're coming, the same ones are coming and saying, we're going to offer you a degree of freedom. And what does this mean? That means you are free to have the expression of the Islam that you want, as long as it is within that holy alliance between those who rule Mecca and Medina and those who rule America and Europe. They can offer Muslims here freedom in this masjid to worship Allah according to the Saudi madhab. Then they can do it in a country as big as Iraq, and even bigger, if that is how you want to understand Islam. Allah's Prophet, may Allah's peace and blessings be upon him, says, Al-Mu'min Kayyisun Fatin. And in another hadith he says, اتقوا فراسة المؤمن فإنه ينظر بنور الله. Avoid the insight of a person who is committed to Allah, because his vision is Allah's vision. أقول قولي هذا. أستغفر الله لي ولكم. أدعوه سبحانه وأنتم على يقين بالإجابة. ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين. وتوبوا إلى الله متابا. وسلم على المبعوث خيرا ورحمة وهدى لكافة الأمم وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. Brothers and sisters, committed Muslims, قل سيروا في الأرض فانظروا كيف كان عاقبة المكذبين. Go forth into the territories of this world. You can go forth physically. You can go forth mentally. Go into the histories of peoples of this world and see what the outcome of those who were trying to falsify Allah, what their outcome was. قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ سُنَنْ تَسِيرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ. Social laws have preceded you. This is another word. Sunan, sunnah, as the word is in Allah's precise book. They can diffuse the word and have the ayah aborted. Social laws, sunan, have preceded us. Who is willing to take a close look at the social laws that have been brought to our attention in Allah's book concerning previous nations, concerning previous states and governments and civilization? Yes, Western civilization has done a tremendous job in discovering physical laws, laws of matter, but they've become a tremendous failure in identifying social laws, the sunan of Allah. And the race is on. The more knowledgeable they are about the physical laws, the more ignorant they become of the social laws, the nearer their time of reckoning will be with Allah. They themselves, they have no reason to factor in Allah's power. Why should they? If they can go around the world and reap the resources and the benefits and the potential and the manpower and the cheap labor of the whole world, why should they factor in Allah? That's going to mean losses. That's going to mean equality. That's going to mean cooperation. These are not words that are plugged into their economic mind or their military mind or even their humanitarian mind. But how about us? We can't be on the same par. We can't equate ourselves with them. They have no Quran, we have a Quran. They have no God, unless God passes as an illusion of sorts. And we have Allah. They have no human behavioral model. We have one, at least. What is our excuse? But you can look around and gauge for yourself those who are observant of Allah and His power, and those who are only satisfied by rendering to Allah lip service and lip service only. Allahumma arina al-haqqa haqqan warzuqna ittiba'ah, wa arina al-batila batilan warzuqna ijtinabah, wa la taj'alhu multabisan alayna واجعلنا للمتقين إماما. ربنا لا تؤاخذنا إن نسينا أو أخطأنا. ربنا ولا تحمل علينا إصرا كما حملته على الذين من قبلنا. ربنا ولا تحملنا ما لا طاقة لنا به، واعف عنا واغفر لنا وارحمنا، أنت مولانا فانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. اللهم إنا نسألك العفو والعافية والمعافاة الدائمة في الدين والدنيا والآخرة. ربنا آتي نفوسنا تقواها وزكها، أنت خير من زكاها، أنت وليها ومولاها، ربنا صل على محمد وآل محمد، ربنا صل على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم، ربنا بارك على محمد وآل محمد، ربنا بارك على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم في العالمين، إنك حميد مجيد. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. والعصر، إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. ومن أظلم ممن منع مساجد الله أن يذكر فيها اسمه وسعى في خرابها، أولئك ما كان لهم أن يدخلوها إلا خائفين، لهم في الدنيا خزي ولهم في الآخرة عذاب عظيم. إن الله يأمركم أن تؤدوا الأمانات إلى أهلها، وإذا حكمتم بين الناس أن تحكموا بالعدل، إن الله نعما يعظكم به، إن الله كان سميعا بصيرا. ولذكر الله أكبر، والله يعلم ما تصنعون. وأقم الصلاة.
الله الكريم بإسمه، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله، حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح، قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة، الله أكبر الله أكبر، لا إله إلا الله.
اللهم رب هذه الدعوة التامة والصلاة القائمة، آت سيدنا محمدا الوسيلة والفضيلة والدرجة العالية الرفيعة، وضح اللهم مقاما محمودا والحوض المورود كما وعدته، إنك لا تخلف الميعاد.
الله أكبر.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا صراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. الله نور السماوات والأرض، مثل نوره كمشكاة فيها مصباح، المصباح في زجاجة، الزجاجة كأنها كوكب دري يوقد من شجرة مباركة زيتونة لا شرقية ولا غربية يكاد زيتها يضيء ولو لم تمسسه نار، نور على نور، يهدي الله لنوره من يشاء، ويضرب الله الأمثال للناس، والله بكل شيء عليم.
الله أكبر.
سمع الله لمن حمده.
الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. بيوت أذن الله أن ترفع ويذكر فيها اسمه يسبح له فيها بالغدو والآصال رجال لا تلهيهم تجارة ولا بيع عن ذكر الله وإقام الصلاة وإيتاء الزكاة يخافون يوما تتقلب فيه القلوب والأبصار ليجزيهم الله أحسن ما عملوا ويزيدهم من فضله والله يرزق من يشاء بغير حساب.
الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر.
أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.